Muchas gracias por estar aquí. Estamos presentando a la doctora Judith Obransky. Viene de la Universidad de Debrecen y es directora del Instituto de Nyíregyháza. Se especializa en biotecnología y en conservación de genética de alimentos. Entonces, si quieres empezar, you want to start
with
your presentation.
Thank you. Thank you very much. On the first slide, you can see our institute, one of our institutes. And in that institute, we can find a biotechnological laboratory. Today, I will speak about the plant biotechnological research in our institutes and a special respect to conservation of genetic resources. You will see with the different biotechnological methods how we can evaluate, how we can select or preserve or even improve the genetic resources. I will speak first about the basic technology of the plant biotechnology, about the in vitro micropropagation and the result in that researches. After that, about some biophysical treatments, which are new now in our institute, but with some good results. About the epigenetic resources, which are based on in vitro plant materials. And about the special aspect of the use of micropropagation, how can we evaluate under in vitro condition the biotic and abiotic stress tolerance in different breeding lines. And after that, about some words about the antiviral chemotherapy in vitro conditions, and finally some other about other methods. First, about the micropropagation. As you can see, or I think you can already know, that there are two main ways how to start micropropagation, that means how to establish in vitro culture. The first one can be, which is based on meristems, either in meristem culture or other parts which contain meristems. These are very stable techniques because those are based on meristems, the propagation of different organs or tissue parts with meristems. So the chance for genetic change is very low. The other techniques when we use any part of the plants, but in that case, if the morphogenesis is indirect, it can be dangerous because the chance for genetic changes is very high. So if it's possible, we use the first technique when the technique is based pre-existing meristems, or the other techniques when we can induce the morphogenesis directly. In the case of in vitro micropropagation, we started to deal with the potato and mainly with in vitro tuberization. How can we induce the in vitro tubers very rapidly and very efficiently? After that, we had to solve the problems of shooting because we had to make the synchronization of the shooting and timing of the shooting, and we made research on the background and on the physiology of the tuberization and the shooting. After that, we made some micropropagation techniques for different herbaceous, like peas, buckwheat, winter wheat, or sunflower. The aim of these researches, of course, was not the propagation method itself, because they are very good, can be propagated very good by not in vitro techniques, but they were necessary for applying other biotechnological techniques. After that, we started to deal with different tree species, first of all with apple and other fruit trees. And in this topic, we studied the axillary and adventitious short regeneration techniques. We made some methods for different silence and rootstocks. And in the picture above, you can see the steps of the macropropagation of April, the establishment of in vitro culture, the shooting and shoot propagation phase, and finally the acclimatization and the acclimatized plantlet. And the other picture shows how different cytokines can modify the morphology of the leaves of April's, and it can be very important in the regeneration process because it can affect it. And on the second picture, you can see the steps of the regeneration. Those were made on special explant, the so-called sensor layer explant, and efficiency of the regeneration could be increased with this technique. And side effect of the research was this last one, the micrografting, when we tried to make grafting under in vitro conditions, and it was very useful after acclimatization. We used the agar-agar, which is normally used for the medium, for sticking the rootstock and the cyan, and on the electromicroscopic picture you can see the fusion phases. And the next step was when we focused not on the quantity aspect of the micropropagation, that means not on the aspect how can we produce more and more plants within a certain period, but we try to make the quality better, because it's very important during and after the acclimatization phase, it's very important how developed the plants are, because the acclimatization rate can be decreased very strongly if the functionality of the photosynthetic system is low. Therefore, we try to study how the different cytokines can affect the effectiveness of the photosystem too. And as you can see on that picture, there were big differences. And the normally used benzyl adenine has a very, very harmful effect in certain scions. So we should use another cytokinins if we want to have plantlets with good quality. And the other aspect what was studied is the gas exchange. It's connected not only to the photosynthesis, but the water balance of the plantlets. And this is the second critical phase of the acclimatization. After that, similarly to the apple and fruit species, we dealt with the micropropagation of other tree species. They were mainly the black locust and different Hugelands hybrids and different forest plants, and we developed the micropropagation technique, and we studied also the genetic stability and the epigenetic changes. I will show you the epigenetic changes in the case of apple a bit later. So before the biological processes and the biological methods, we started to examine how different processes affected by background, so what is exactly the background of different processes, and how can be mathematically modeled. The first examination was made on the in vitro tuberization, and what was the surprise, that the background was the wide solanum species. That means how many times and in which combination we cross the wide solanum species into a variety and not the maturity group, because until that point in the literature everybody says that everything depends during the in vitro microtuberization on the maturity group, but this was not true. We realized that and we tried to guess then what is the cause, and the real cause was the wide genome in the variety. After that, during the regeneration and during the studying the effects of cytokines of regeneration, we made an organogenic index, which was good to measure the quality plantless production during the propagation process with this equation, where we try to estimate how different processes will affect the production of healthy plantlets, that means with good quality. And we put into the equation the shoot number, what can be regenerated on one explant, the regeneration percent, and the vitrification percent. The vitrification of a plantlet means that its quality is very low, and in generally, these vitrificated plantlets, they are vitrificated because those can be seen just like a glass after the regeneration, but they are not able to survive the in vitro process. During the acclimatization, they die. That's why it's important to measure its ratio. And the other modeling was when we try to compare how the different explants can affect the regeneration process. So until that point, we measured how the different chemical and physical conditions affect the regeneration process as usual. But finally, we tried and studied only one biotic part of the regeneration process, the explant. And we found that its size and shape is very important and can be independent of the other processes. And if you compare two different explants, that means with different shape and size, then there is an equation between those which can be determine the regeneration capacity of the different explants. And within that, we made the geometric factor, which depends only on the shape of the explant, independently of other processes. Indeed, can affect the regeneration success and the regeneration efficiency. So back to the biology. The second topic, which is relatively new topic in examination, is how the different environmental stimuli can be used in the in vitro conditions. How can we use them for increasing the production, the micropropagation, or the regeneration? These can be used also in the micropropagation itself, and this is also a good model for measuring the effect of these physical stimuli, because the physical signals are very important in the plant lives, and this is a new finding in the agriculture because the people can realize that they can be used also on the field. But the use of those factors like magnetic effects or ultrasound or sound effects are used only on empirical way. So we know only few things about the backgrounds. So we started to examine those in vitro conditions. They are not only signals in the life of the plants, but also stress factors. So we tried to use and studied both aspects of that factors. and we tried to deal with the ultrasonication and the effects of ultrasound on the in vitro plant development, first of all on axillary shooting, and the second topic was the adventitial shooting in two different model plants, the potato and the apple. And what we know that that sound and ultrasound effects depends on their frequency, their period, their distance from the plants, but from the other side also the developmental and organization state of the plants, that's the species, the variety, or even the exact genotype. So the first examination focused on ultrasonication as a stress factor, and we try to find out what kind of stress reply will be induced, and how can the stress enzyme level changed, or which pathways can be induced after ultrasonication. We tried many combination, many period of the ultrasonication and at different kilohertz. And finally, we found that one, which was beneficiary for growing and increasing the development. And we know from the literature that not only the ultrasonication, but the sonication itself can cause modification in the growth and development. And as you can see in the picture, in some developmental process, its effect was already realized. Under in vitro conditions, we used two different types of ultrasound generators. We ultrasonicated the plant threads through air and through a liquid, that means through a medium, a liquid medium. And we used the two model plantlets, as I told earlier, the potato and the apple. And now I will show some results from the potato experiment. This is the first, this is the April, and the second one, the first examination on the development of potato. And after that, we focused on the ultrasonication through air, and we used leafy one-node segments for ultrasonication, and we examined the effects of the ultrasonication in different sampling times for one subculture, that means 4 weeks. And after 4 weeks, we will have the whole plantlets again. So in the first examination, we saw that ultrasonication increased the shoot development and the shoot growth. Transiently inhibited or delayed the root development because the ascorbic acid level was very low immediately after the ultrasonication. Later, the increased ascorbic acid and glutathione ratio and two forms of glutathione increased, and it caused and increase the shoot development rate. And what we realized that under in vitro conditions, one pathway of the stress response in the plants was blocked because there was not selenium in the medium, and one of the enzymes of that pathway, what can be seen on the right side, is selenium dependent, but the other way was induced, and it was enough to eliminate the stress effect of the ultrasound. But after that, by changing the ascorbic acid level and the glutathione level, the redox potential changed in the plantlets and in the explants, and that what was caused and increased the growth of the shoots. After that, we wanted to know what happened exactly in the plantlets, in the level of the genome. because there was only few examination in which it was clear that the expression level of some enzymes increased or decreased, but there was not a whole picture. Therefore, we repeated the experiment. We sampled the plantlets or the explants at 5 times, as you can see, at 0 and 24, 48 hours, 1 week after the ultrasonication, because that was the most intensive phase of the growing, and after the one subculture, at the end of the subculture, exactly at 4 weeks. We made a total messenger RNA transcriptomics, and we saw that, as you can see in the picture and different sampling times, that the transcriptomics is very different. The up and down regulation was also typical, and as you can see in the picture on the right side, the up-regulated genes, number of the upregulated genes was 159, but the down regulation was also typical. It affected more than 200 genes. And we saw also in the protein picture that it caused changes not only in the messenger level, but at the protein level. And after the transcriptomics, we tried and CAG-mapped the changes. So that means we tried and found that changes how connected to the biochemical processes. And we realized that it affected the lot of metabolism in the plantlets, the lipid metabolism, signaling, carbohydrate, amino acid metabolism, also the nucleotide and vitamin metabolism, and some stress-related pathways like carotenoid, phenylpropanoid, or flavonoid biosynthesis. And on the first picture, we can see that processes immediately after the ultrasonication. But what is interesting, after 4 weeks, at the end of the subculture, the after effects was much higher. That means much more biochemical processes was affected than directly after the the ultrasonication. So we tried and continued these experiments, and we made the same examination in the case of ultrasonication through liquid, and the pattern is very different. It's very strong if we made the ultrasonication through a liquid, and we realized and in that case a bunch of heat shock proteins were activated, but were not activated in the case if the ultrasonication was made by air. So this is an exciting topic, I think. And if we go forward, the next exciting topic nowadays, the epigenetics. When we realize changes in the plantlets or in the crops, but we can't find the real genetic background. So the alleles are the same, the genes are the same, but the changes is real. And the cause of those are mainly the epigenetic changes. We tried and measured the DNA methylation level. This is one form of the epigenetic variation. What is still can be still typical, the chromatin methylation, acetylation, or the small RNA population changes. And by whole genome bisulfite sequencing, we measured three samples. We had in vitro micropropagated plantlets from in vitro cultures. They were already 20 years old. That means we maintained that cultures under in vitro conditions for more than 20 years. We had samples from the in vitro model plants, which we had when we started the in vitro propagation. And we tried and acclimatized the plantlets and grow them up for 1 year. So we had samples from 3 different environments, from the original environment where the mother plants were, from the in vitro environment, and from the acclimatized environment. And we compared the methylation level of those. And what we found that the global DNA methylation level of the 3 samples were the same. So it was no difference. It was an interesting finding because in some cases others found differences in the global methylation level itself. But in that case there was no differences. But what we found that in the case of more than 50-100 or almost 60-100 genes, the methylation level changed depending on the environment. And there was 4 genes where always changed the methylation level in all conditions. And what can be seen on that picture, that the methylation of that genes, that not only genes, but also their promoters were examined. So in those cases, not only the environment was important, as can be seen in the pictures, but also the cultivar we compared to cultivar, tocin cultivar of the apple. And it was very different how they replied to the different environment. And it was an interesting finding in the sense that where the changes were bigger, the acclimatization level to the different environments in vitro conditions was also bigger. And the highest level of the methylation of those genes that was examined was found in vitro conditions, which is not a surprise because under in vitro conditions some function are unnecessary. So if the genes are highly methylated, the function of those genes is blocked. So there is no transcription, there is no function. But it can be changed when we put the plant into the normal condition again. And the acclimatized plantlets, the level of the methylation became similar to the mother plant slowly, but became similar. And some pictures how processes they, how biological processes those methylation affected, and they affected some molecular processes, mainly the protein binding and hydrolyzed activity, which is not a surprise if we consider that the transcription changes. And what cellular compartments are affected, and mainly the integral component of the membrane that is affected, and also the nuclear parts. And a special part, how can we use the micropropagation technique for evaluation of different genotypes and then use that results in the breeding works is the in vitro testing methods. That means that we try and develop different short techniques. That means that we can have the result within 1 week or within maximum 10 days. And we can use those for evaluation of a series of genotypes. And how can we define these in vitro evaluation methods and why they are important? in vitro cultures or organs, that means organs which originated from the in vitro conditions like in vitro tubers, can serve and a useful tool for these testing methods. And we will see how can we use for the evaluation of the methods. And they are important because they are very short, as I said. They are safe and cheap. Safe is important if we try and examine pathogens which can be very dangerous. But under laboratory conditions, it's easy to do. Those techniques have four phases. First, we have to select and maintain the virulent strains of the pathogens. In the case, if we try and examine biotic stressors, then we should develop the appropriate infection method, which is not an easy way under in vitro conditions, because the symptoms sometimes can be different than in field conditions. Then we should develop the evaluation method, and finally we have to be able to isolate the pathogen from the infective plant parts, and we should compare if the number of the pathogens is in connection with the symptoms. So in the case of the second phase, the first phase is that we should select the target organ. That can be stem, leaf, tuber, or even flower. The way and tool of the infection. How can we infect the plant under in vitro conditions that we under sterile conditions without killing the plantlets. And in the next phase, we should describe the symptoms under in vitro conditions. We should determine the symptom scale, the disease rate, and we should determine the sensitivity categories. And I already said the fourth phase, the isolation phase. So just two examples for those. The first is in the case of the apple, the Erwinia amyloidea, which caused the fire blight in the apple. And in the picture, you can see the different scale of the symptoms under in vitro conditions. The first is the healthy plant, where there is no symptoms. And on the other pictures, you can see the phases of the browning and the phases of the symptoms, which started with the browning just near to the cut part of the plantlet, and finally the whole plantlets can be brown, and all of the bacterial exudate can come out of the plant on the surface on the plant, or even on the surface on the medium. And in that case, when we know already the symptoms, we can compare the different varieties, science, genotypes. In that case, we see the comparison of different cyan varieties. And as can be seen on the pictures, there are three classes of the tolerance from the susceptible to the moderately resistant according to the level of the disease rate. And the other example, also the Erwinia, the other Erwinia in the case of the potato, which can cause the black leg, which is a typical disease in the case of the potato. And we compare the different varieties, different clones and breeding lines in the case of Erwinia carotovora, and we made the different tolerance categories from the highly susceptible to the resistant But we examined also the other Alvinia species. This is all this, which also can cause the black leg in the case of the potato. And we can see that in that case, the rate of the disease is very different, and according to that, also the level of the tolerance can be different. So this method in the case of the pathogens can be used not only to differentiate the different clones according to the susceptibility, but they are also suitable for evaluate the virulence of different strains. In that case, what we saw, the virulence of different Alvinia species against potato. So very quick methods. In the case of April, the evaluation occurred after 1 week. In the case of potato, after 10 days. And still only one example when we use not exactly the in vitro organ, so we apply the method not under sterile conditions, but we collect the in vitro organs, in that case the in vitro tubers, and we evaluate the level of the susceptibility of different varieties. On the first picture, you can see the different level of the symptoms, and below that, in four clones or four varieties, the level of the susceptibility. And the other part of this test, when we examine and note the susceptibility to different biotic stressors or to different diseases, but to different abiotic stressors. For example, osmotic stress tolerance can be very, very good evaluated by these methods. In the case of potato, we used three different osmotics, and we compared its effectiveness, and finally we found the right osmotics and evaluation way how we can compare the susceptibility level of different clones, as you can see in the case of two osmotics in the pictures. And now another topic which is very important in the case when we want to evaluate our genetic resources for healthiness. That means if they are able to crosses when we want to increase the tolerance to different stressors, to different pathogens, in that case to viruses, we examined the breeding material in the case of potato for susceptibility to two different potato viruses, the M and S viruses, and we found SCS primer. This is a very easy technique, molecular technique, when we were able to differentiate the resistant and susceptible potato clones. Another primer was also suitable for that. But by using those primers, we were not able to differentiate the tolerant, only the resistance and susceptible. Therefore, we use another techniques, the temperature switch PCR, when we were able to differentiate also the resistant, the tolerant, and susceptible clones. And another important aspect when we have to put the genetic resources into a gene bank, for example, that we should put them there in a healthy state. In the case of the potato, it's a challenge to make it free for from viruses. The original technique used ribavirin for virus elimination, but its effectiveness is very low, about 30%. And this is a very expensive antiviral agent. Therefore, we tried and combined different antiviral agents with different mode of actions. They are used in the human medicine, and we found some combinations which were able to eliminate the viruses in about 70-90%, and were more cheaper than using only the ribavirin. And this is only a technique how can we measure the virus freeing of the plantlets. This is the ELISA technique. I think you know that technique when we use an immunosorbent technique for the evaluation, just using the plant saft for the evaluation. And still some words about other techniques that can be used and which based on the genetic resources which we can store and collect. We use the embryo rescue for making breeding material from different crossing different species. It was very important in the case of different Phagopyrum crossings because the embryos can die after the pollination if we leave in the plant those embryos. But if we can prepare them, we can grow them up and we can use it for later crossing, and we can transmit the self-pollination, for example, into the crop. And still a few words about gene techniques at our institute. Gene banks can be different. The normal gene bank means the seed collection in some ways. There are basic collections and active collections. We also have a seed storage gene bank in our institute, but we also have an in vitro collection. In vitro collections and in vitro storage techniques are very useful if we are not able to use the seed collection. For example, because the seed doesn't represent the original genotypes, that's the situation in the case of heterozygous or clonally propagated plants, for example, in the case of potato or different ornamentals or fruit crops, where the normal propagation method is the clonal propagation. Or in the case when the plant is not able to develop seed, or it is able but the seed is sterile. In the case of in vitro collection, of course, we maintain the plant material under sterile conditions, and that means that we can control all the conditions, that gives the possibility to us to use different types of techniques, like slow growth storage techniques or cryopreservation. Cryopreservation is a bit complicated techniques. It needs a high technical level, but slow growth storage can be used very easily, and it's a relatively cheap way to maintain the collection. This is good for a medium-term conservation, while the cryopreservation is good for a long-term conservation. In the case of slow-growth storage, we have two types of methods, the classical methods and some alternative methods. In the case of classical methods, we modify the environmental, mainly the physical conditions of the in vitro culture or the medium content of the in vitro culture, and through those we can maintain the plant material and we can reach that we shouldn't propagate monthly or every 6 weeks the plant material, but once or maximum twice a year. The technique of those methods can be the temperature reduction, which is very beneficial because for seed storage we use for Celsius degrees, and this is also good for the temperature reduction and the in vitro conditions, or we can apply lower light intensities or even the darkness. In the case of the tree species, we try to use the temperature reduction to 4 Celsius degree and kept the plantlets in darkness, and they survive without any genetic or serious physical modification for more than 1 year in the dark and cold conditions, and after that we can subculture that very easily. And the other possibility, if we modify the medium, we can reduce the sugar content, for example, or we can apply osmotics into the medium. It was very effective in the case of the potato, for example, to put some osmotics into the medium, and by this the growth was very slow and they can survive for more than 1 year without subculturing. And the other possibility, by applying the alternative methods, which can be different, we can apply different mineral or paraffin oil or just a liquid medium pouring onto the culture, or changing the gaseous environment of the in vitro culture or vessel itself, or we can use the encapsulation of the expands, which is used also during the cryopreservation, but this is a different technique, but can be used also during the slow growth storage. Anyway, in our institute, the maintenance of in vitro collection based on in vitro short cultures of the different crops, mainly as can be seen in the table, in the case of different potato clones, that means Hungarian, different Western European clones, and a lot of breeding lines, more than 86, but 86 is for varieties. And we tried and maintained for in vitro gene bank also some mainly fruit crops, but some other species like sorbus or strawberry, but those are rather exceptions, but mainly fruit crops, and some forest crops are also in our collection. So shortly, that was what I wanted to tell you. That was just a list of research work, but I think that it's clear that all of those can be used for conservation, or all of them are part of the techniques which are necessary for the real conservation work. Thank you very much.
Could you go back to the last slide, please?
Which one? This one? Okay. It was too much.
I have a question. What do you think about the preservation of Hungarian varieties. Do you think it's important for Hungarians to get other varieties, maybe to preserve in the, for the stock, for example, or for wood? Will the climate change, will be not enough for the wood?
Not only Hungarian, yes, it's important, not only Hungarian, but all of the clones or varieties which came from the old schools of the breeding, because in the, those cases, the breeding for different resistance was very important. Nowadays, for example, in the case of the potato, it was not important. So there are many potato varieties on the market, came from Holland, for example, for Netherlands, for example, which are very sensitive to different pathogens, to different environmental conditions. Okay. But if we have the old varieties, so the varieties from the old Hungarian or German schools, we have the stocks for different pathogens, for the tolerance to different environment.
Yes. When you were talking about acclimatization,
yes,
you mentioned that there are some genes that do change when you, like in methylation processes. Do you know what are they related to? No, I'm
I don't understand exactly what kind of acclimatization. What is at the end of the propagation? Do you mean that one?
No, we were talking about an experiment in which you were measuring. In this is a methylation.
What? Measuring what?
In this case, DNA methylation. Yes, and what is the real question? Yes.
So, in general, it seems not to be a big difference, but there are some genes that actually
yes.
What are they related to? These genes in the
Yes, this is a different topic, but are now examined by us. We compared the DNA methylation level and the transcriptomic level, and it seems that it is connected to the genes which are silent under in vitro conditions, because the plant doesn't need it, or those. Because a plant under the in vitro condition doesn't need to make flowers, for example, or fruits. But if you put back to the normal conditions and it start to grow and develop, after that the methylation level decrease and all of those genes start to work. But there is a close correlation between the methylation and transcription level.
We have to give it too much information.
Okay, thank you very much.
In Europe, you have certain species food that you eat more frequently than Oslo, because we have a different environment ecosystems. What I wonder is if you are thinking in some alternatives, the impact of some of the climate change impact on these species that you are eating. You ate a lot of potatoes, carrots, onions, cabbage, and is this climate change affecting the severe the growing of these crops that you comparing with in vitro systems? You probably will guess that you can establish new ways of
planting. Exactly, and you can test the level of tolerance in a breeding population or in a collection against new pathogens which come because of the climate change from south part into our country, for example. So, or the situation is same if you want to test, for example, the osmotic stress tolerance. That's why it's useful. And also the collections, why they are useful. Because maybe you don't use a variety since, I don't know, 50 years, but suddenly you found a very good tolerance against the new pathogens in that genotype. In that case, you can use it for breeding work, for example.
Do you have any questions? ¿Si han visto diferencias en el uso de luces LED con las fluorescentes en el desarrollo de las plantas in
vitro? Have you seen difference, no? Have you seen LED lamps, no?
So the difference between LED lamps
We didn't study that, but there is difference, yes. And there are some species in which cases the LED lamps or the combination of different LED lamps can be used very well under in vitro conditions, but there are several species in which cases it's impossible because they will not grow. But we don't know the real case. I think we should find a real combination of different LEDs. It's a good topic because you can decrease the cost of the propagation if you use LED lamps. But it's not good for all.
Si podría aclarar si el uso de luces LEDs es negativo al crecimiento, le perjudica el crecimiento. O sea, entendí que las combinan, pero hay una tendencia a quitar las luces por el ahorro de energía.
Vannak olyanok, amin elszar, mert még nem fog nőni, azt mondja.
Have you seen any difference between using sleds or the other one in the effect of the response of the in vitro, no?
Yes, there are differences. I didn't study that, but what I know from the literature, there are differences. That's why the LED techniques right now is not good for all species and not applied for all species yet. But this is only the question of the time, I think.
Thank you.
Okay.
Entonces empezamos con la otra.
Yeah, we can go out.
We can continue.